Hi, welcome to Books in Action. I'm Melissa Kopecky, the director of the South Orange Public Library, and I'm delighted to be here and have a chance to speak with a local author. Marina Budhos lives in Maplewood, and she has come to join us and talk about some of her whole range of books. So, Marina, what would be the first thing you would want to say about being an author who lives in Maplewood, New Jersey?
Like a lot of authors, I think most people sort of write autobiographically in the beginning. Although, interestingly enough, I would say that I didn't so much write autobiographically, but I wrote a novel that was somewhat based on my prehistory as opposed to my history. That first novel is House of Waiting, this novel right here, which was the first book that I worked on. I'm afraid that might tilt. And House of Waiting is actually set in the 1950s, which is before I was born. But it took as its seed the story of my parents meeting. My father was an Indian immigrant, but from the Caribbean, and he was a student in the U.S., and he met my mother, who came from a Russian Jewish background and an observant family. So it was a very dramatic story of them coming together. But I didn't so much want to write a story that was their story. I really wanted to fictionalize it. And even then, I would say, I've always been interested in writing fiction or writing stories in which the cultural and political backdrop is significant to the story. And in the case of House of Waiting, the male character, who I suppose you could say is lightly based on my father, gets drawn into a political election. It's Cold War politics at the time, and there's a political election that's going on in his own country, and he sort of leaves the woman that he's in love with to sort of mysteriously disappear to be part of this election. And this is all based on an actual election that happened. It's all based on real figures that were going on there. So I think even from the beginning, I was playing around with an imaginary story, but an imaginary story that was playing with nonfiction or history or research in some way. So that was my first novel that I wrote, and that was an adult novel.
And what did your parents think of it?
Well, my father was no longer alive. Yeah. I mean, the book is dedicated to him. And I think my mother was totally stunned because she didn't know that in a way, it's a novel that's based on my listening, right? Because it's not autobiographical to me. It's really, it's what I heard about and in some sense what I observed. But I really, as I said, was delving into prehistory as opposed mm-hmm. to my own history. Right after I wrote that, I mean, I kind of fast on the heels of it, I started another novel, which was The Professor of Light. That was my second novel. And I would say that is the only work I've done that more closely hewed to, again, using something that was from my background and my childhood. And it's about a young girl named Maggie Singh, and she comes from the kind of background I have, which is half Indian, half Jewish. But in this case, her father is a professor of philosophy, and he has decided that he is going to solve sort of one of the most confounding paradoxes, which is the particle wave theory of light, which is that light is both a particle and a wave, which is contradictory. I mean, it makes no sense. It's a paradox. But he sets out to solve this. And so it's actually a kind of coming of age story about Maggie and her father and her family and that particle wave obsession of his, because it does become an obsession, is also meant to be a kind of meditation on identity when you're from these different backgrounds, when you're from a kind of diaspora background. In a way, you're both sort of solid and you're wave-like. Yes. So, again, it's entirely imaginary. This is the one novel or one works thus far where I delved a little bit into magical realism. I wanted to play around with that in the storytelling, so there's just a touch of it. And it also, the structure of the novel is each chapter is a different summer in the growing up of this daughter. Mm-hmm. And so it moves from summer to summer until she's sort of on the cusp of her, you know, her young adulthood. So that was my second novel that I published.
And but you didn't finish your thought about your mom and how she felt about House of Waiting.
Well, I think she was just really thrilled that, you know, I had found a way to.
She really felt like you had understood what the context of their lives.
Yes, I think, and that period and that era and what that was like. Yes, very much so. And it was funny, I just came from staying at a friend's apartment, and he had taught the novel in an Asian American literature course many, many years ago, and he asked me to inscribe the copy he had, and I sort of saw the underlinings. I mean, I haven't looked at the book in a really long time. And I think, when I saw what he was underlining, in many ways I was really exploring what it was like to be a mixed couple in the 50s and to go against the grain and some of the sort of subtle things that would go on, for instance, just even finding an apartment and how difficult that was, which was true. These were the stories I heard. So I was, you know, I think, yes, I think she was really surprised that I had been listening closely to those stories.
And, I mean, ever since these, you've kept that sort of under theme of what life is like when you're not mainstream.
Yeah, I think in a way, if I could say I had, you know, material, I think, particularly in my fiction, I am interested in stories that are unseen by people who might be unseen. Somebody asked me recently in an interview, even within the context, let's say, of, you know, the category of South Asian writers, I tend to even write, so for instance, my novel Ask Me No Questions is about Bangladeshi immigrants, or in another novel I wrote about a young Indo-Trinidadian girl whose mother is a domestic, is a nanny and housekeeper. And she sort of noticed that, you know, I kind of write about maybe characters that are not so much seen or perhaps marginal in a way. And it's not as if it's an agenda of mine, but I think it's the stories that I'm drawn to. I feel perhaps a kind of sympathy. I'm trying to look at the world. I'm trying to show how the world looks from those perspectives.
Well, and particularly as a reader, even of adult things, but for YA, I think it's so important, young adult, teen reading. And there's such a growing number of crossover people I know,
right.
So many adults who read the YA. And I think it's because some of the best of it does sort of open your eyes to something you haven't thought of before, which
right.
is, you know, just a great thing for teenagers, sure. But it's really nice if it can do that for adults as well.
I think that's right. And, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about why is young adult so popular now? And now there's even this thing called, I think it's called new adult, which is, you know, I guess it's even characters who are in their 20s. The Fault in Our Stars, for instance, is called new adult. And I think there's a couple of things that YA allows us to do. One, it stays very close to the point of view of the characters. It doesn't tend to be as broad and omniscient approach. You know, it's not, I think the teen reader is not as interested in a more diffuse or distant kind of narration. So it hews fairly close, even if you have several characters or several points of view, it stays fairly close to those points of view. So I think that allows for a kind of immediacy in the writing that you do in YA. I think there's two other things that are exciting about it. One is, in many ways for me, YA became a place where I could remember and feel reinvigorated about storytelling. Because when you're writing for a teen audience, you know, you have to be a good storyteller. You know, they're not going to wait around. And, you know, as a writer, that was actually great training for me because it forced me to really be clear about my storytelling and not sort of dally around quite as much. So that's something else. And then finally, I think to your other point, in YA, part of what we're trying to render are these different worlds, right? And so it could be Harry Potter, rendering that world of Harry Potter or Hunger Games, but it also can be realism, where you're trying to sort of show this, you're trying to envelop the reader in a world.
Right. And I mean, you're successful if you draw them into the world, real or magical, but how nice to draw them into a world that's very real,
yes,
but something they have never experienced.
Exactly. Yes.
Which is, we're going to have to take a break in a minute, but I really want to talk about your Ask Me No Questions. That even made me think of things that I'd been trying to think of from that point of view and hadn't really gotten there. It sucked me in, and I really appreciated that. So we're going to take a break, and we'll be back.
After 17 years working as a mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
Welcome back to Books in Action. I'm Melissa Kopecki. I'm still the director of the South Orange Public Library and still the very lucky sometimes host of this program. And still very lucky because Marina Budhos, I got it right, mm-hmm, is our guest. And if you're just joining us, she's a Maplewood resident who's written some wonderful things, and we're about to talk about, in particular, is this a good time to
go
into a little bit about Ask Me No Questions?
So we were talking about the whole idea of rendering a world, and you were saying kind of the necessity of rendering a world that maybe people haven't seen or haven't had a chance to think about, and to sort of provoke them to think about that, and to provoke teenagers to think about that. So a lot of my work fuses my interest almost as a journalist, where I'm kind of seeking out certain kinds of stories. And so when it came to Ask Me No Questions, I became really interested in that whole post 9/11 period, right afterward, about sort of the fate of the undocumented Muslim community, which was really hit very hard right after 9/11. We had something called the Muslim Registration Act, which was part of the Patriot Act. And so you had droves of men 18 years and older, if they came from Muslim countries, had to register with the government. As such, they may have gotten detained or deported. Their families were kind of stranded in a way. It was really an atmosphere of incredible fear, you know. So I wanted to tell that story from the point of view of two young girls, two sisters who could be any two sisters, who find themselves in this kind of predicament. So, you know, it was a book that I wrote very quickly because it was kind of hot inside of me. I wanted to kind of tell this story. And it involved a little bit of research, but I'd been really thinking about it for quite a while, this whole story of what it would be like to be so invisible for a while, and then suddenly after 9/11, you're almost too visible. And the, you know, what it's like to be a teenager where you think you belong, you know, you've come here, your parents have brought, you know, they're struggling to get by, and the rug is pulled out from under you suddenly. You know, your father knocks on your door and says, you know what, we have to leave for Canada. So that's kind of the story I wanted to tell.
Well, that was the piece of it that really caught me too, that idea of jumping in a car. And I mean, I know a family who I was very close to who moved to Canada.
Right.
But this idea that you're just gonna hop in a car and see if you can get across the border,
right,
was just a whole, you know, what a leap of faith, or
right,
not, maybe not faith, but just fear, a
right,
leap of.
And there was a lot of fear. There was a tremendous amount of fear. A lot of fear in the community and a lot of confusion. You know, should you register, should you not register? You know, we're now, we're many years out from that particular moment in time, but we're still grappling with issues of immigration. You know, it's still something we're trying to sort out.
Right up on the top again.
We're still grappling with our understanding of what it means to be in a post 9/11 world. And, you know, the other thing that, one of the reasons I wanted to tell this story is, again, of course we knew the story of the attack and, you know, the really tragic aspect of the families who were affected. But again, this was an invisible story. People didn't know about all of these kinds of families that had been affected post 9/11.
Right, with the one sister so very successful in school, and this was stuff that their best friends at school didn't know about.
Right.
I just want to diverge for 1 second, because here's the paperback version and the hardcover,
right,
and we were looking at those ahead of time. This is completely up to the publisher how they choose to package it?
Yes, to some extent. I mean, I can nix, if I feel really strongly, I can nix a cover. You know, one has sort of consultation rights, but they're not the strongest of rights.
Yeah.
And in the young adult market, the way they think about covers is the hardcover, which I actually love this cover, is marketed for you. It's marketed for librarians and libraries, because the hardcovers tend to be in the institutional sales.
Let me point out something that's very nice as far as a library, that they actually have that on the binding.
Ah.
So if you have it shelved this way, I thought that was really nice. That's very unusual.
Very interesting. Yes, I didn't realize that. So a paperback cover is totally meant to more be to appeal to the teenager. And so that's why this is such a different cover. I mean, the kids ask me about this all the time. Did you pick the model, you know, when I go to schools and so
right,
forth? And I'll be perfectly honest, this doesn't look anything like my character. It looks more like her sister, actually, if I were to say. It looks like Aisha, the older sister. But anyway, a paperback cover is much more meant to sort of get to the teenager, hoping the teenager will pull it off the shelf.
Well, and yeah, I mean, as a librarian, I mean, I've read reams of articles about people debating, is it
right,
good to have an actual person
right,
there, or does that make it too specific, and
right,
actually, on and on, which is interesting. So we can jump into this one, Tell Us We're Home, which is
out a few years ago, yeah, yeah.
And very different covers again.
Right.
And, but this, the choice is no face, no
right,
personal connection, right, but
I was actually very happy with that paperback cover.
I like this
cover.
It's
evocative,
a lot.
And I think I'm, you know, yes, I tend to like sometimes when it's a little more evocative and abstract than necessarily literal. But yes.
So do you want to tell us a little something about this?
Sure. And in fact, I'll also mention that so Tell Us We're Home followed after Ask Me No Questions. And it was written during the period when I myself had become a mother and was making use of babysitters and nannies, and became sort of fascinated with that relationship, because in a way, we often have immigrant women who are taking care of our children or cleaning our houses and so forth. And yet, what sort of happens to their children? right? What happens to the children of the caretakers? I began the book thinking I was actually doing a nonfiction book, and decided once again, this often happens to me, the nonfiction part of me research and sort of digs around for something, and before I know it, a story comes
alive,
to me.
Right.
And I decided, around the time I was working on this, we actually moved to Maplewood. And so I kind of stowed this idea away. And for me, moving to the suburbs, quite honestly, was an immigration for me. I did not grow up in the suburbs. I grew up in New York City, and I was very much sort of a city girl. And so it was all kind of new to me. And so I thought, you know, I could sort of pour my own observations in while writing about outsiders, you know, in other ways. And so what I wanted to do was write a girls' friendship novel, a novel that's about mothers and very much about mothers and daughters, but told from the point of view of these three girls. There are three girls. The main character is Jaya. She's from Trinidad. There's also Maria, who's from Mexico, and Lola, who's from Slovakia. And what they share in common is that their mothers are maids and nannies in a suburban town. And so they go to school with the children whose families their mother worked for. And I wanted to kind of tell a friendship novel from that story. One of the interesting things, which I think I had mentioned to you, is that the novel has gotten some interesting traction among mother and daughter reading groups.
Oh, I can imagine, yes.
Yeah, because it's another way of thinking about mother and daughter relationships, but it's got this complication, right? And so just recently, I decided to create a mother-daughter discussion guide because, you know, sort of these mother-daughter groups were reading it in a way, you know, it had been compared to The Help in a sense, but it's a more contemporary version. And it's really about mothers and daughters and how they, how does a young girl, a teenager whose mother is working in this way, how does she kind of find her footing? In this circumstance.
And how wonderful, I mean, I know for book groups it's wonderful to have any kind of reading guide, but to have one created by the author is actually like a really personal.
Yeah, I mean, I worked with somebody who creates them, but we did it together.
Right.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right, which is impressive. We're just flying through time here.
Yes.
And there's two things I want to make sure we cover, and one is your book Sugar, which is back there, and we'll let it show. And right here. And this is amazing. And as a nonfiction reader, as a librarian, as someone who likes nonfiction written for younger readers, this is impressive. The context of everything is wonderful. The research is amazing. So I want you to talk a little bit about like the research process and how you put together a book like this.
So this is a book that I wrote with my husband, Mark Aronson, who is an historian and writes for young adults. And we cooked up this idea together when we both realized that we had sugar in our background. His from via Russia and mine via the Caribbean, because my ancestors came from India to the Caribbean to work on sugar plantations after slavery was abolished. And so we were really struck by the idea that there is this one substance. You know, our families came from different parts of the world, and yet, you know, it utterly changed our ancestors, members of our family. So we decided to kind of trace this substance. We're often asked, you know, how do two people write one book? Mark drove a certain amount. He drove a lot of the research in this book, although I knew a lot about the last portion of the book, which has to do with indentured and the indentured story, because I've been doing quite a lot of research on that. And I'd actually been reading things like overseers' manuals about how to run a sugar plantation and so forth. So, you know, it was a labor of love. I have to give him the credit insofar as he is a master of putting together visuals with text. And he's always taken control of that in his books. So I think that's another way in which the research was also in the visuals.
And that is very impressive in this. And I
we're gonna like leave. We have 1 minute left to talk about what you have on your plate. So we'll just tell people this is available at the libraries, at bookstores, and it's very, very cool. So you have to give me the really, really brief version.
Okay,
of
I'm gonna
what
be really brief.
Really brief.
I will say that Mark and I have another nonfiction book that is going to be coming out in 2016. That's about the photographer Robert Capa and Gerda Taro and the Spanish Civil War. I'm not going to say anything more. It'll be a highly visual book.
And then, is that also like sort of for a YA
yes,
sort of crossover
absolutely,
market?
Absolutely. Okay. That's coming out with Henry Holt. And so that'll be coming out in 2016, the anniversary of the Spanish Civil War. And then I am deep in researching and writing a follow-up to Ask Me No Questions. And what I will say is it's not the same characters, but it's about the same immigrant world. It's about surveillance, post 9/11, and it is about a Muslim teenager who himself becomes an informant on his community. And I'm not gonna say anything.
So do you promise you'll come back and talk again about those two books?
Yes, I will.
Okay. I got your promise and I got it on tape. Thank you very much.